Hare Krishna, welcome all to the Bhagavatam discussion. Today we are reading from third canto, chapter 18, verse number 2. Dadarsha tatra bhijitam dharadharam pronniyamana vanimagradam shtraya मुष्णन्तमक्ष्णास्वरुचोरुणश्रिया जहास चाहो वनगोचरो मृगः ददर्श तत्राभिजितं धराधरम् प्रोन्नीयमानावनिमग्रदंष्ट्रया मुष्णन्तमक्ष्णास्वरुचोरुणश्रिया जहास चाहो वनगोचरो मृगः. Word dadarsha, he saw, tatra, there, abhijitam, the victorious, dhara, the earth, dharam, bearing, pronniyamana, being raised upward, avanim, the earth, agradamshtraya, by the tip of his tusk, mushnantam, who was diminishing, Akshna, with his eyes, Swaruchaha, Hiranyaksha's own splendor, Aruna, reddish, Shriya, radiant, Jahasa, he laughed, Cha, and Aho, O, Vanagocharaha, amphibious, Mrugaha, beast. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada ki jai. He saw there the all-powerful personality of Godhead in his boar incarnation, bearing the earth upward on the ends of his tusks and robbing him of his splendor with his reddish eyes. The demon laughed. Oh, an amphibious beast. Puppet. In a previous chapter, we have discussed the incarnation of the Supreme Personality of Godhead as Varaha, the boar. While Varaha, with his tusks, engaged in uplifting the submerged earth from the depths of the waters, this great demon Hiranyaksha met him and challenged him, calling him a beast. Demons cannot understand the incarnations of the Lord. They think that his incarnations as a fish or boar or tortoise are big beasts only. They misunderstand the body of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, even in his human form, and they deride his descent. In the Chaitanya Sampradaya, there is sometimes a demoniac misconception about the descendant of Nityananda Prabhu. Nityananda Prabhu's body is spiritual, but demoniac persons consider the body of the Supreme Personality to be material, just like ours. Avajananti mam mudaha. Persons who have no intelligence deride the transcendental form of the Lord as material. So we'll have prayers and then we'll begin. ॐ अज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनाशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः. श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपः कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं. वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरोः श्रीयुतापदकमलं श्रीगुरून् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगण रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवम् साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधा कृष्णपादान् सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च. नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिन्निति नामिने. नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे. नमो महावदान्याय कृष्णप्रेमप्रदायते कृष्णाय कृष्णचैतन्यनाम्ने गौरत्विषे नमः। हे कृष्णा करुणा सिंधो दीनबंधो जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिका कांता राधा कांता नमोस्तुते। तप्त कांचन गौरांगी श्रीराधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये। वांछा कल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभो नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्णा हरे हरे, हरे रामा 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 हरे हरे।
हरे कृष्णा। सो हाउ मेनी ऑफ यू नो चक्रपाणि कृष्ण गुरु? Okay, some of them don't know. So His Grace Chakramana Chakravani Krishna Guru is a very dear friend of mine. We know each other since many years, about 10-12 years. He became a devotee when he was studying in NITK Suratkal. I think 2006-07.
Yeah.
So he was a topper in the college. And when preaching was happening there, they were staying in a small center. But then preaching expanded so much that they felt the need of a bigger center. So then they purchased a land, and then under the direction of His Grace Sadhguru Prabhu, they personally built that building. They are watering, they are putting bricks and getting bricks and getting stones. Brick by brick, that building was built. Of course, by the donation of many other devotees, and especially His Grace Keshanand Guru's father. And then preaching increased like anything, and more than 30 devotees were staying at one point of time. And just for doing that service, he did M.Tech and he stayed there. Otherwise, he could have taken up job and gone, taken job. And so that shows his dedication for the preaching mission. And later on, he took about 1 year training in Pune, in Brahmacharya Ashram, and then he got married. And now he's doing his PhD. Mm. PhD in Indian Institute of Science in computer technology. So, and now also, along with his college and PhD, he's taking a lot of responsibilities in Nagar Bhavi Center, where there's a wonderful congregation coming up under the direction of His Grace Ravindra Anitai Guru. Beautiful center, small center, but a lot of devotees. When we have Zoom call, about 70-80 devotees join every day. So, beautiful center. And he's also a good Kannada preacher. So he's doing a lot of Kannada programs. And Karnataka needs a lot of Kannada preachers. He's taking that initiative. Even in our Kannada channel, he puts a lot of content. So, so we thank him for coming here today, along with his good wife. So we welcome both of them to ISKCON Cultural Center by loudly chanting 3 times. Haribo! Haribo! Haribo!
Hare Krishna. So I heartily thank all the devotees for providing me this wonderful opportunity to purify myself by diving into the nectarian ocean of Srimad Bhagavatam. Of course, sky is the limit to the depth of the understanding. But just like how a bird can only fly up to the capacity what the bird has, similarly, I can discuss according to my level of realization and understanding. So I would seek the blessings of the Lordship, Shri Jagannath Balabhadra Subhadra, Shri Gaur Nithai, Srila Prabhupada, all the assembled devotees, to bless me so that I will be able to do this service to the best of my capacity for my purification. So we're in the discussion of the battle between Lord Bor, that is Varaha, Bhagavan, and Hiranyaksha. So in the previous chapters, the victory of Hiranyaksha. So there we have seen a couple of important incidents. So just quickly visit some of the important verses. So yeah, one of them was that Diti was fearful what kind of children will come out. So I think for 100 years, both Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu, they stayed in the womb of Diti. And it was suffocating the entire universe. So finally they came out. But after they came out, again, there are a lot of calamities. So there is a shloka, which shloka number 15, it says that, marking these and many other omens of evil times, everyone but the four sage sons of Brahma, that is Chatushkumaras, everyone except them, okay, were seized with fear. And why they were not seized? Because they were aware of the fall of Jaya and Vijaya and of their birth as Diti's sons. So others, they did not know the secrets of these potents and thought that the dissolution of the universe was at hand. So again, the bodily features of these two demons, something extraordinary. They were so huge that, you know, their sky, head was about to touch the sky, means that clouds. There is a way, you know, people saw that. And their bodies began to grow just like two great mountains. And they blocked the view of all directions, just like if there is a big mountain in front of you, you can't see what is the other side. So they blocked the view of all directions. And while walking, they shook the earth at every step. Okay. And Prajapati gives names to the children. He gave one of them as Hiranyakashipu, other is Hiranyaksha. So the elder one is Hiranyakashipu, though the firstborn was Hiranyaksha. So the reason behind that is, who was conceived first? So they're like twins, but who was conceived first? Hiranyakashipu was conceived first. So hence he is considered elderly, not the child which comes out of the womb first. So that is one aspect. And Hiranyakashipu, as all of us know, took that benediction, that famous benediction from Lord Brahma. And after that, he was completely fearless because he knew nobody can take that form to kill me. And they started committing a lot of atrocities. And Hiranyaksha also, he took his club and he wanted to fully support his brother always. And it is said that Hiranyaksha's temper was so difficult to control. And his bodily strength and the boon what he had got from Devatas, it made him proud. Okay. He feared death at the hands of no one. So as a result, all the Devatas, whenever they saw, I mean before even they see him, before even he comes to their place, they would flee in fear. So just like how snakes, they fear Garuda, so all the Devatas, they started fearing Hiranyaksha. So he had that sensation, itching sensation of, like he wanted to display his power and fight with somebody. But nobody was, you know, willing to fight against him because they knew that, you know, he's having all these powers and they can't do anything to him. And finally he goes to the Varunaloka, the lord of oceans and waters. So he goes there and he tosses the waves of ocean again and again and again with his mace. And finally he reaches the capital of Varunaloka, that is Vibhavari. Okay. And then apparently Hiranyaksha fell at the feet of Varuna. And in a mocking way he asked, "Oh, Supreme Lord, give me battle." So he was mocking him. So Varuna actually, of course, became angry, but he curbed it. And then he says, "Oh dear one, I have grown old now. I will not fight anymore. So you are so skilled in war that I do not see anyone else But the most ancient person, Lord Vishnu, who can give satisfaction in battle to you. So you approach him and fight. Okay? And then Varuna cautioned him. He cautioned him, saying that once you reach him, he will rid you of your pride at once. And you will lie down on the field of battle surrounded by dogs for eternal sleep. So, just to exterminate wicked people like you, he takes various incarnations. So, like that, Varuna gave him that, you know, tip. And then coming to this chapter, yeah, Maitreya mentioned that, you know, this fellow was so falsely glorious and proud. He didn't, heed the caution-filled words of Varuna. And then, with the help of Narada, he came to know about the whereabouts of the Lord. And then he quickly hurried to the depths of the ocean. And from there, we get to today's verse. Today's verse. So, again, I'll just read the translation. He saw there the all-powerful personality of Godhead in his boar incarnation, bearing the earth upward on the ends of his tusks and robbing Hiranyaksha of his splendor with his reddish eyes. But the demon laughed, Jahasa laughed. Aho, vanagocharo mrigaha. Oh, this amphibious beast. So Prabhupada writes in purport that actually one of the previous chapters, this Varaha Avatara was discussed. But in this particular chapter, the addition is that the pastime of the battle between Varaha and Hiranyaksha is discussed, which was not discussed before. And the word here in this name, Dadarsha Tatra Abhijitam. Abhijitam means who has, conquered in all directions. Okay? That is Supreme Lord. And also, Abhijitam is also another meaning of the word Abhijitam is one who is the Lord or the presiding deity of Abhijit constellation. And it's also mentioned that Lord Mushnantam, that is diminished, Akshna with his eyes. What did he diminish? Swarucho Runashriya. Arunashriya means his reddish eyes, and Swarucha means Hiranyaksha's splendor. Whatever power was there in Hiranyaksha, just by his glance, okay, Lord removed that. So just like we have here in the Kurukshetra battle, okay, so because by the glance of the Lord, you know, he was able to remove the powers of all the Kauravas, and they used to, you know, succumb to the prowess of Pandavas. And there is one specific adjective used by this demon Hiranyaksha to refer to the Lord, that is Vanagochara. So Vanagochara, so there are two meanings to Vanagochara. One of the meanings is that Prabhupada translates as amphibious. Okay, so amphibious is a very apt definition, because there are two meanings to the word Vanagochara. One meaning is one who resides in forest or who wanders about in forest. Okay, the other meaning of Vanagochara is that one who is living in water. Right, so in this Vanagochara has these two meanings. So the demon's abuse. So he was practically trying to mock. Hey, you are a beast and you are a Vanagochara. Yeah, he was trying to mock. But actually, yeah, devotees, they see the glories of the Lord even in the apparent mocking by the demons. So Vanagochara, another meaning of Vanagochara can also be Lord Narayana. Because Vanagochara can be Narayana because Narayana sleeps on water. That ocean, right? So, Narayana is also known as Vanagochara. And this Mruga, Vanagocharo Mrugaha, this is the word he used, Mrugaha. So, this Mruga means search, right? So, Mruga Trishna we saw, called, right? Sada. So, Mruga is also searching after. So, Vanagochara, the Supreme Lord Vanagochara, he is searched after by the sages. So, that's why this Vanagocharo Mrugaha. And another meaning of Vanagochara is that Lord has to be searched in isolated places like forest. Okay? Not in a villa or not in, a city like Bangalore. Anyway, that is the meaning of Vanagochara. So the point is, okay, I may be living in a city. Then does it mean that I will not get the Lord? No. The thing is, one has to have that kind of focused connection towards Lord. Okay? Because the problem is when you are living in such kind of corporate cities and all, there are so many things happening around you. Right? Constantly there is news coming in. And the nature of life is so passionate and dynamic. So as a result, we tend to get distracted. Our mind focuses on so many other things that though we give the time for morning program and things like that, our mind is actually not having that kind of focus because of so many inputs which can distract us. So, though I may be living, among such crowd and among such burst of information, etc., but our focus and mentally that meditation must be constantly there on the Lord, that we should seek after the Lord in our hearts. Yeah, Prabhupada also mentions about how these demons, they think so high of themselves. Whatever little material achievements or material opulences they possess, that only makes them arrogant and proud. And that acts like a covering where they cannot see the actual glories of Supreme Lord. So that is why Kunti Maharani also prays Janma Ishwarya Shudashri Veda Manamata Puman. Because all these opulences, having great birth or having lot of wealth or having learned so many things, right? Or having extraordinary beauty, bodily beauty, things like that, they tend to make us proud and we fail to feelingly call out the names of the Lord. Right? So in this context here, these demons, what they do is the biggest blunder they do is avajananti mammudaha manushim tarimachitaha. They tend to look at the form of the Lord as material. And they think so high of themselves, right? They try to diminish the glories of the Lord, in their mind, of course, and they falsely puff themselves up. So Prabhupada mentions about how Savar Sampradaya, there is some misconception among some people of how they don't recognize the spiritual body of the Lord. So that is avajananti maam mudaha. That is foolish people, mudaha avajananti. They deride the Lord as manushim tanum ashritam. That he has taken a material form. Because the problem is because param bhavam ajananta. They don't know the divine position of the Lord. Okay. So here I have mentioned like in the previous few shlokas, how the appearance of these two demons was like a calamity. People were really so fearful. They thought dissolution is about to take place. Okay, so like this in life, calamities do happen. And calamities are so frequent. So we are, unfortunately living within such a huge calamity, which has just, sort of faded out, but it was there for so many months. This corona pandemic. Okay, it was such a calamity in so many people's lives. Okay, some of us, we did not face that severity, but there are so many people who faced the severity of disease. That is one thing. Second, there are people who got affected because of the restrictions put by the government to avoid the spread of the disease. So like this, it was a calamity. It was a huge calamity. So then, why do these calamities come? This is one of the questions which come to our mind. So, there's a couple of reasons for that. is these calamities, they remind us of our material tabernacle. In the sense, otherwise we tend to overlook, and whatever little pleasures we can accumulate, we identify ourselves with that, and we tend to overlook the reality that where we are now. So we are in a place which we call as forest fire, right? So there is a serious problem here, but we tend to overlook that. So that is one of the reasons why calamities come in our lives. And other reason is nature of this world is like that. Like we know from Bhagavad Gita, Dukhalayam Ashashvatam. So when the Pandavas approached Bhishma Deva, when Bhishma Deva was about to pass away, so that time Bhishma Deva says that usually everything is controlled by Kala in this world, right? But Kala can give us whatever pains or difficulties owing to our prarabdha, that is our past karma, right? Kala will not influence in a way where it is not because of past karma. For example, so corona pandemic was there, but still some people did not face any heat of that, but some people faced such a heat of it, they were really completely devastated by that. So the disease was there everywhere, right? It was spreading, but why some people got hugely affected, why some did not get affected? So another reason is there because of their prarabdha karma. So then in that case, what about Pandavas? They faced such huge problems, which we can't even imagine. And that too being one of the purest devotees of the Lord, right? They had offered everything to the Lord. So the Bhishma says, actually, it's not just that they were devotees, it's also that materially also they were so powerful. Bhima and Arjuna, nobody could touch them. We know that incident where Lakshagriha was burnt, Pandavas were sort of in exile. They had dressed themselves as wandering Brahmanas, and they had gone to the Swayamvara ceremony of Draupadi. There, all the great kings, including Duryodhan, I think even Jarasandh, everybody, all the powerful kings were there in that assembly. Even Shalya was there, Karna, everybody was there. And they all could not accomplish the task. And then finally, when Arjuna accomplishes and Draupadi, puts her that mala on Arjuna, so all these kings, they get so agitated. So how come a Brahmana is taking away a Kshatriya queen meant for any one of us? So we could not get that. So they all become so angry, they attack. And just Bhima and Arjuna, they were able to ward off all these kings. That was their prowess. Okay, materially. Spiritually, if you consider Dharmaraya, Yudhishthira, he had no trace of any sins. So if you consider Prarabdha is a cause of their miseries, no trace of any sins in the life across Yudhishthira's life, right? And also spiritually, they were great devotees of the Lord. And Lord himself was there to support them at every step of life, right? As their family member. So even then, they had to face all this. So then Bhishma says that actually, there is no reason we can supply to the miseries and difficulties what you have gone through. So we have to just accept it. We cannot give reasons and justify it, why it happened. Just accept it is happening. That is the nature of this world. So that is how calamities come. So hence, as devotees or as normal people, as anybody, calamities do happen. Okay, we cannot say that, now I have taken up 16 rounds and Krishna consciousness. No, calamity should not come. We cannot think like that. Calamities, in fact, the outside circumstances are always there, but they will either harm us or help us, right? Depending on the outlook what we carry towards those calamities. Right? Similarly, if you take example of the same Mahabharata, Karna also had some difficulties in his life because he didn't actually get to know that he's from a great dynasty and things like that, and he suffered because people were not ready to teach him and things like that. So, but one cannot play that victim card, right? So, because he had faced some of these difficulties in his life and some humiliation, so he wrongly sided with Adharma, right? So the Pandavas, though they faced so much of difficulties, they never gave up on what is Dharma. Yudhishthira was ready, give me only 5 villages, right? And even at the end, when Duryodhana was a single person left and all other warriors, they had died, and Duryodhana was inside that pond. He was hiding there. Even there, what Yudhishthira says is amazing. He says that, Duryodhana, just choose one of five, one of us. No, if we are five, just choose one of us. Whomever you choose, they will fight with you. And if you can defeat just that one person, you can take back your kingdom. I mean, just imagine. They had fought and they had killed practically everyone. And even then, Dharmaraya was so selfless. And the reason why Dharmaraya was made to approach Bhishma, one of the reasons is because he was so despondent, he was so disturbed. He was lamenting that because of me, now all this war happened. Though it was, I mean, the last person to blame for the war is Yudhishthira. He was never, willing for the war to happen. But still, he took all the responsibility that because of me, this war happened. Right? That is the nature of Dharmaraya. So, the attitude and the outlook, okay, what we carry in life, right? That can actually make the situations favor our goals, right? All of us have that common goal of developing Krishna consciousness and, becoming pure and, end of life, going back to ordered. That is there. So then all the external situations will only favor our goals. If our conviction towards our goal is strong, right? Whatever situations come, they will only favor us. It's like a favorable wind which is floating on ocean, which helps the boat to flow towards the destination. And as again we have discussed, how the nature of these calamities is universal, one and all. Even the great devatas, they also face calamities, right? So nobody is excused from the problems. And some of the tips what we have learned from this particular section of Bhagavatam on how to face such calamities. So when all these ominous signs were shown, right? I mean, were seen. Everybody, including all the devatas, they were also disturbed, except for Chatushkumaras. They were not so disturbed. So what can be the reason? The reason is that because they knew who they are, and they knew what is going to happen. So in this way, one of the solutions or one of the ways to face these calamities is by dint of knowledge. Right? By the dint of knowledge of Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita, we know that we expect that things are not going to be very smooth sailing. And we expect that some of our material plans will be frustrated. Right? So as a result, our attachment to the fruits of our acts will be less or removed. So hence, we only focus on doing our karma yoga, nishkama karma yoga, and offer it to Krishna. So right? So that is one way to live in this world happily amidst any calamity. And other thing what we saw in the same section is previously when this Hiranyaksha approached Varuna. So how did Varuna face or avoid this calamity, you can say? So we saw that Varuna humbled himself, right? He humbled himself by saying that I am old, now I'm not doing any war now. And he also glorified the Lord. So he mentioned how Lord is so powerful and he's the right match for you. Right? Similarly, in our life also, when problems come, we don't have to think that, I am so capable to overcome this problem. We can humble ourselves. And we can keep faith in the greatness of Lord, that He is so powerful, He is so capable, right? So when problems come, let us not look upon the problems as so big. Instead of that, what we can do is, let us tell to the problems that our Lord is so big, and you know, you are insignificant in front of that, right? So that kind of humility, where you know, we don't try to, you know, think that I am capable of tackling it myself, but we depend on the Lord. So this dependence on the Lord and the prowess of the Lord, on the, you know, unfailing promises what Lord has given to His devotees. So putting faith in all this, right? That is very important. Putting faith in the words of the Lord in Bhagavad Gita, when He says, you know, Name Bhakta Pranashyati, Yoga Kshema Mahamyaham. These are the unfailing achyuta. Lord is achyuta. Unfailing commitments, promises, what Krishna has made for His devotees. So that unfailing faith, right? That is going to give us such strength to overcome any calamity. Okay. And then again, the divine and demoniac. Who is divine? Who is demoniac? If you want to really categorize them, see, having some material opulence doesn't make us demoniac. Okay. Or not having any material opulence doesn't make us divine. Right. So the real thing is about the qualities what we carry, especially the Shraddha in the Lord. That's why in the devotional 9 steps of devotional process, what is the first step? The first step is Adav Shraddha. So where is your faith? Is your faith in devotees and Krishna, or is your faith in your own material plans? Right? So here Hiranyaksha was putting faith in his own prowess and his own plans for his happiness. Right? And a divine person, he will put faith in the Lord, like Varuna. He will put faith in the Lord, and he knows that Lord will surely make us victorious in our life to reach our goal. Right? So many times we tend to think that, you know, are we repeating? Are we repeating more than, you know, what is needed? All these basics of Krishna consciousness. It tends to get, you know, repetitive. We tend to think like that. But it is not like that. The example we can give is just like a tree, right? Or a plant. You have to water it daily. You can't say, I water it once and, you know, I have watered it, so it will grow by itself. No, we have to water it regularly. Similarly, our faith, right? Our faith in the Lord, especially when it's in tender stages. Most of us, yeah, I do believe that we are in tender stages of our faith in the Lord, right? So it is highly essential that we protect it. Okay? We protect that tender faith, what we carry. So many situations come in our life which tend to disturb that faith. So what we are going to sacrifice? Are we going to sacrifice the faith, or are we going to sacrifice some of our material plans? Because our plans, they are not perfect. Right? What is plan of the Lord for us, that is always going to be better than what is plan of my plan on myself, right? For my future. So that's why putting faith in the plan of the Lord. Putting faith in the Lord, right? So that we should reinforce regularly. The reinforcement, right, is like putting water to that tender creeper or tender plant of faith. And it's so essential that we strengthen it regularly, right? One thing is to avoid any other attacks on that faith. Second thing is to water it, okay? So that is so essential. And when that faith becomes so strong, right? So that is when actually we start to see miracles in our life. I mean, so miracles doesn't mean that, you know, somebody is dead and he'll come back. Not that kind of miracles. But seemingly unsurmountable problems tend to become that water in the calves, you know, puddle, that whatever, that little bit of water. Seemingly unsurmountable. It's like ocean of problems tend to become that kind of. It do happen in the life of devotees. It does happen. So again, before we complete the discussion, one of the another important points is Lord incarnates in among various species. Like Lord incarnated, and also the purpose is that he wants to serve the purpose of that incarnation. For example, why he incarnated as a fish, because he had to save the species from the devastating water, pralaya waters, right? So pralaya waters were everywhere, so he had to take the form of fish to save that. And why did he take the form of a tortoise? Because he had to support that huge mountain in the ocean, and tortoise was the best, you know. Similarly, why he took form of Varaha? So he took the form of Varaha because he had to go to Rasatala, that Garbhodaka ocean. He had to go and lift earth, just like how this boar, right, wild boar, right, it goes to all these kind of dirty waters, right. Similarly, Lord had to go to that kind of place to lift earth and come. So Lord doesn't think that, oh, this incarnation, what is this? It is a lower animal or something. No. Because the moment Lord takes incarnation, so we should see that form is apparently some animal, but actually it is spiritual form. So when the Lord came, and then he came out of the nostril of Brahma right that time, and then he shook his body, then all the from hairs of his body, the water droplets, it sprinkled, and all the sages, they were so ecstatic when it fell on their body. Right? So Lord's form is always spiritual. So there is no contamination or dirt which can sit on the form of the Lord. Right? He's like fire. What happens, anything comes in contact with fire, it completely gets burnt. So in that way, Lord's form is always divine, always spiritual, no matter what form he takes. So, but again, this demoniac people, they tend to think it as material, and they tend to demean. What is this? You call him as Lord, see? He's taking Varaha form, boar incarnation, like an animal, and he's going everywhere. What is this? So they tend to mock. But as we saw, devotees, even when the demons mock, they tend to only see the glories of the Lord. They tend to, so that is our attitude. As devotees, we never want to, get offended by all this. So we always want to twist, turn. There are other, so many meanings possible, right? So, and then we can consider that even an offending words by a demon can be converted. So just like how when you throw a dart, but actually it can become flower for Lord because it doesn't affect him anyway. So in that way, devotees tend to have their outlook towards life. Okay. So by this, I will pause the discussion. So I'll open it if you have any questions or any comments.
Hare Krishna. Do you have any questions? You are mentioning about seeing the aligning ourselves with the plan of the Lord.
Yeah.
But sometimes, many times it becomes difficult to understand what is the plan of the Lord.
Huh.
Then how to align?
Yeah. Yeah, very, very nice question. So when you say aligning with the plan of the Lord, it's like, we don't know what it is. It's an uncharted territory we are trying to enter. But the thing is, the connection with the Lord is important. Okay? So we have to strengthen it. So how do we strengthen the connection? So one way is to calling out the names regularly, what we chant. The other way is to immerse ourselves, right, in the words of Krishna, so or the pastimes of the Lord. So immerse ourselves. So basically, our connection do matter, and also our connection to devotees, okay, who are capable to guide us, right? Because I may be confused. Aligning with the plan of the Lord means what? Yeah, it means you take shelter of the process. Okay, when you take shelter of the process, there will surely be inspiration given in our heart. Dadami buddhi yogam tam enama upayantite. So when we align with the process, what is given known to us, which we know, right? I know that I have to chant when I know that I have to take shelter of devotees. I know I have to take shelter of scriptures and Shravanam. That is known to us very clearly. But when I do that sincerely, Dadami Buddhi Yogam Tam Enamam Upayantite. So that Buddhi Yoga is given by the Lord. And following that is what meant by following the plan of the Lord.
Wonderful. Mm-hmm. Hare Krishna.
Yeah.
Okay. So, how we can avoid suffering? So, Chatuskumaras, they knew how this Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakaspu are coming from Jaya and Vijaya. But one of the German philosopher, we have a discussion, Prabhupada was one discussing with Shyam Sundar Prabhu, on many philosophers. He tells with intelligence, knowledge means intelligence, comes more suffering. So, okay. How do we see that?
Yeah, so the thing is, intelligence and knowledge both are not exactly same. But you can say that because you have intelligence, you can acquire knowledge. You can say like that. But the thing is, where is the intelligence applied? It is applied to speculate. If it is applied to speculate on the causes of miseries or how to overcome these miseries, right? So then what will happen is we are not in a mood to take shelter. We are in a mood to challenge, okay, now I'll somehow overcome this. So in that sense, intelligence can cause greater misery or greater complications, right? But the same intelligence applied to take shelter of the process, by trying to really understand what Lord wants. Right, by reading the books or by associating with devotees, by discussion of philosophy, right? Using intelligence in that way can actually help us. So that to acquire the real knowledge, real wisdom, right? So when we have that real knowledge and real wisdom, that will help us to see the reality as it is. Means we don't magnify the problems. Most of the time what happens is the problems gets magnified when we come close to. I mean, less like how the hill is far, it looks very small, but when we go close to the hill, it appears so big, right? So similarly, the problems, when they come to our life, as long as it is there affecting somebody else, we are not actually disturbed much. But when it comes to our life, what happens is we tend to get confused. So that support to overcome that kind of confusions and is provided by that kind of genuine wisdom or the knowledge what we can acquire by the process of Krishna consciousness.
We understand that devotees in any profession, they will remember Krishna and they'll work. But my question was, I had heard that in Kali Yuga, Brahmanas will easily take to qualification, easily learn all the material qualifications. So how to understand that point?
Can I repeat it slowly again? I didn't get the exact point.
In Kali Yuga, it is told that the Brahmanas will easily take up to material education very fast. What to do? How can we understand?
Okay. So, if I understand your question correctly, Brahmanas tend to acquire material education easier or faster than others. Right? That is what. There are two aspects to it. One aspect is some faculties which are stronger. For example, people who have Brahminical tendencies, they naturally have brain more developed. And people who have Kshatriya tendencies, they're naturally, their physical body is more, developed. I mean, that's how their mentality will be, right? If you remember, I don't know if you remember in your life, but if you have seen maybe even Prabhupada Leela, that we see that when Prabhupada was a very small baby, they had kept different things, Bhagavatam and many things. And then they leave the child, go and pick up whatever, right? So that is an indication of what is their mentality and tendency towards, right? So I am giving this example because a person based on his varna or whatever, so he will have a natural tendency to acquire certain things. So now how to use it? So though he is from a Brahminical background, he has Brahminical tendencies. But he will not become a real Brahmana unless he develops the qualities of a Brahmana. And even that is not enough. Pralamata says, even if a Brahmana with all the 12 qualities of a Brahmana is not enough to even save himself, forget about others. Right? So devotional service to Lord is what is the crowning jewel, okay? So that is most essential. And all other things are like feather. One is crown, other things are feather. Feather can be added, no problem. But most important thing is that crown. So bhakti should be there, and on top of it, whatever. It doesn't matter whether you are materially, like education, you can capture more, or you have some other occupation, for example, you can do business better. It doesn't matter really. Whatever is our genuine tendencies, if you are capable of doing good business, go ahead and do it. There is no problem. But again, the connection is to be with Krishna and offer the results and fruits, whatever is our nature of work, towards Krishna. So, but if somebody misuses, somebody uses the Brahmanical tendencies and just acquires material knowledge, and then he runs away from Krishna, he runs towards all the material achievements, then he is lost. He didn't use the assets given to him. Am I clear?
Why Brahmanas are becoming
yeah.
educated,
yeah, couple
not
of
studying shastras?
Couple of reasons. One reason is that there is, in general, there is fall of the Varna system. There is a fall of the Varna system that the samskaras are not being given to people, right? So people are losing on samskaras. So as a result, whatever their faculties, they are training, running towards material goals only. If the right samskaras were given, what is really important in life? Right? So that's samskaras, especially when childhood, we have to give samskaras. But what is happening nowadays? Everybody is given the same type of education where everybody is made to chase a particular material goal, that's it. Okay, but each varna, they had to get that kind of samskara. If they don't get that kind of samskara, their future life, you know, it will not be based on that kind of, their tendencies. It will not be based on that. Right? So,
my question is connected to a previous question. Like, as you mentioned about aligning ourselves to the plan of the Lord, so taking shelter of the process, so this will help in aligning in like spiritual terms. But when we want to align our plans, material plans, with the like Lord's plan, so how to understand that?
Yeah. See, for a devotee, especially, if somebody is genuinely wanting to practice Krishna consciousness, right? Then even his material achievements are actually part of spiritual achievements only. For example, he sets up a good family, for example, right? He has to have a good home and things like that. But ultimately, what he will do in that home, he will keep the deity of Krishna and he will worship. So how can it be purely material? It is not purely material. For a devotee, especially, right? So even his material achievements are actually spiritual achievements. Right, in that sense, I want to say that. So that's why when you try to become more and more Krishna conscious, right, by following the process, then you will also align your material plans in alignment with your spiritual goals. Your material plans will not be something tangentially opposite to your spiritual goals. You will always align it. Right? Even though you may earn a lot of money, you will always ensure that you donate it to the services of Krishna consciousness. Right? So it will happen in that way.
Don't mind, you would like to share something from your life where you faced the calamity and how you came out so that we can also get benefited from that.
There are many, actually, in the sense couple of them, if you want me to mention. So one of the things is that during my BTEC, I had to, my future decision, right? I had to make, whether I'll do BTEC or I'll continue with some type of job. So one thing was clear, we have to be an association of devotees in those days. I mean, especially in those days, we were always running towards Pune, right? Pune was the hub in those days. Anybody, anywhere, they always want to get a company which is in Pune. So that was our goals and targets in those days. I got a placement in, so many times what happens is you tend to struggle a lot to get into a particular company. It doesn't happen. And you just go and sit in some other company's interview and very easily you get selected, whatever an experience. Some of you would have surely experienced that. So I got selected in one company known as ST Microelectronics, which was having good name in that field, and it was in Delhi. Okay, and I sat for a company in Pune, which is Amdocs. Okay, and that was apparently, much easier to get selected than this ST Microelectronics. So there also I went to the interview, but on the interview panel, somehow, for whatever reason, I could not answer or whatever. Not only the technical aspects, but even the other questions, what he was asking. No, it became a mess. So I didn't get selected. Though it was very easy. Okay. So then finally, I had to make a choice. So then I had to prepare for, so we thought I'll do M.Tech. And then prepared for GATE for 1 day. Okay, just 1 day's preparation, or maybe 2 days preparation. Okay, and then and then finally just wrote it, and I got a very decent rank. And the rank was not good enough for IITs. I had to stay in NITK because of that. So just giving this as an example of how. Now, what is the plan? You just have to align. No, it happens. You just have to do your part and it happens. So it is sort of a miracle only, right, in that sense. But just recently, there's some other more miracles have happened, in, which I don't want to simply share and say. Once I come out of it fully, I'll share. Okay.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you very much for taking out your time and coming all the way to temple. So we thank His Grace Chakrabani Krishna Guru by Lord chanting one time Hare Krishna mantra.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Krishna Krishna. Hare Hare.
Hare Rama.
Hare Rama. Rama Rama. Hare Hare.
Hare Hare.